So today we'll be taking up one more sutta for discussion, and this is also a sutta which is of question and answers. So this is called Chula Vedanta Sutta. This is Majjhima Nikaya 44. We did Majjhima Nikaya 43 yesterday. So this also has question and answers, where one person comes to another person and asks question. But there is an interesting story in this, which is from the commentaries, which kind of elaborates about the relationship between the questioner and the questioning. So we will start. Thus have I heard, on one occasion the Blessed One was living at Rajagaha in the bamboo grove, the squirrel's sanctuary. Then the lay follower Vishakha went to the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina, and after paying homage to her, he sat down at one side and asked her. So over here, Vishakha is the lay person who has come to Bhikkhuni Dhammadina. Bhikkhuni Dhammadina and Vishakha had a relationship. They were husband and wife. So Vishakha was going to the Buddha and practicing. And in the due course of his practice, he became an anagami, a non-returner. One of the things about an anagami is that there are no lustful feeling an anagami can feel. So he expressed to his wife Dhammadina that they cannot live together, or if they live together, they have to live together as brother and sister. So Dhammadina said that yeah. So that is because that is a pure mind. They cannot have lust, anagami, a non-returner. Thus, Dhammadina said that I also had a wish to follow the Buddha's path and become a nun. But I did not, because I did not want to disappoint you. So that is the reason. Then one reason why Vishakha could not become a monk was he was a treasurer. He was a very wealthy man, but he was a treasurer for the king. So one of the rules of monkhood is that you should not have government responsibility, because if all the government officials became monks, then the country can become weak, and the kings can kind of get angry with the followers, you know, of the Buddha. So that is the reason. One of the rules was that if you have official capacity, then or official responsibility, then you cannot become a monk. So he wanted to also. He was a responsible person. He was in charge of treasury, and he was a wealthy businessman also. So he said that I will take care of my responsibility, and Dhammadina became a nun, a bhikkhuni. That's the reason the bhikkhuni word has been mentioned over here. And after she became a nun, she progressed and she became an arahant. Dhammadina. She became an arahant. And she was foremost in wisdom in the bhikkhuni order. So as Sariputta, in the bhikkhu order, is considered to be the most wise, Dhammadina is considered to be the most wise in the bhikkhuni order. So अभी ये जो शुरुआत हो रही है यहाँ पे Vishakha आता है Dhammadina, जो bhikkhuni Dhammadina है, और bhikkhuni Dhammadina के साथ में उनका पहले संबंध था, दोनों husband wife थे, means वो एक दिन Vishakha आता है, बोलता है कि मैं अनागामी हो चुका हूँ, तो मैं आपके साथ में अभी रह नहीं सकता, क्योंकि हम अभी जो है क्या बोलते हैं हस्बैंड एंड वाइफ की तरह नहीं रह सकते हैं. तो फिर Dhammadina ने बोला कि मुझे भिक्खुनी बनने का इच्छा था, तो मैं अभी आपका अगर परमिशन रहेगा तो मैं भिक्खुनी बन जाती हूँ. तो फिर उन्होंने क्या किया कि वो भिक्खुनी बन गई Dhammadina, और उनके प्रैक्टिस के बाद, बुद्ध का वचन सुनने के बाद भी वो अरहंत हो गई. और Vishakha जो था वो राजा का जो पैसे का वो देखभाल करता था। वो खुद भी एक अमीर ये था, मर्चेंट था, मीन्स ये था व्यापारी, व्यापारी था। तो वो उसने अपना जो जो उसके रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी रहती है उसके जो उसके आधार पे वो बहुत सारा चीज़ें राजा करते थे और उनको पता था कहाँ कहाँ सोना है उनका और कहाँ कहाँ उनके पैसे हैं। तो वो उसी हिसाब से वो छोड़ नहीं सकते थे और वो बन नहीं सकते थे भिक्खु। मगर वो फिर अभी यहाँ पे आते हैं और उनको कुछ सवाल रहते हैं तो वो सवाल पूछने यहाँ पे आते हैं। तो ये सवाल जवाब होगा, देन ही कम्स ओवर हियर टू जस्ट क्वेश्चन एंड कॉस्ट क्वेश्चन एंड क्लैरिफाई हिज डाउट्स। ही इज आल्सो वेरी एकम्प्लिश्ड। यस, in suttas there are certain places where a lay person has become an arahant, but that is mentioned in the time he fell near to death. That is the reason I told you about the anagami also. Anagami can become an arahant at the time of death, during the process of death, at the moment of death, or while going to the brahmaloka. So and other options. So there has been not any mentions. And one other clear mention about lay person being arahant or not is in Vachakota Sutta. There was a merchant who used to ascetic who used to come to Buddha and ask a lot of questions. So once he asked, is there even a one person who has become a Sotapanna in your teaching? So Buddha says, not even one, there are more than 500 monks who have become Sotapanna. He said, are there nuns? So he said, not one, but more than 500 have become Sotapanna. He asked, lay person? So he said, not one, but more than 500 have become. Lay woman? So not one, but more than 500. So over the course, everything he is talking about, he talks about anagami also in the same way. Not even one, more than 500 people. When he talks about arahant, he only mentions monks and nuns. He does not mention lay people in that sutta. So that is a kind of clear indication that they were not a lot or it was not common enough for him to say that not even one but more than 500 lay people have become arahants. That was not a statement he could have made, Buddha. So that is an indication. One other place where it is mentioned as a lay person is his own father. Before his passing away, he on his deathbed he became an arahant. But he had not ordained. He was a king, so he had responsibility. So he had not ordained. So that is the thing. Now the question's answer is also very interesting, which will happen. Lady, identity is said. What is called identity by the Blessed One? Now the word identity is also used as personality. Bhikkhu Bodhi in his previous translation had used personality. यहाँ पे एक identity का मतलब है कि व्यक्तिगत होना क्या चीज़ है। तो व्यक्तिगत जो है हम लोग बोलते हैं कि अव्यक्तिगत है हमारे जो विचार है ये सब। तो ये व्यक्तिगत बनाए के बारे में पूछ रहे हैं कि व्यक्तिगत क्या है, what is an identity? Friend Vaishakha, these five aggregates when affected by clinging are called identity by the Blessed One. That is material form aggregate when affected by clinging, feeling aggregate when affected by clinging, the perception aggregate when affected by clinging, the formations aggregate when affected by clinging, and the consciousness aggregate when affected by clinging. These five aggregates affected by clinging are called identity by the Blessed One. तो ये पूछते हैं कि ऐसे कौन सी चीज़ें हैं जो आपको ये व्यक्तिगत बना करता है। तो उन्होंने पांच चीज़ें बताई जो है। पहला है शरीर या काया फॉर्म, उसके बाद है फीलिंग मीन्स वेदना, और उसके बाद है परसेप्शन मीन्स दृष्टिकोण, उसके बाद में है फॉर्मेशन। फॉर्मेशंस का मतलब होता है शंखारा, या उसको बोल सकते हैं थॉट्स भी बोल सकते हैं। थॉट्स भी एक तरीके से और विचार व्यक्त करने के लिए फॉर्मेशंस है, मीन्स वो भी एक तरीके का शंखारा है। तो आप बोलचाल के भाषा के अंदर उसको विचार भी कह सकते हैं, क्योंकि ये जो कॉन्सेप्ट है ये बहुत बड़ा है और बहुत सारा इसके अंदर ये हो सकता है, इलाबोरेशन हो सकता है, मगर हम जितना हो सके उतना सरल रखते हैं यहाँ पे। एंड द कॉन्शियसनेस, कॉन्शियसनेस विज्ञान, ये सारी चीजें जो है ये मिलके एक व्यक्ति या एक आइडेंटिटी होता है। Seeing good lady and the lay follower Vaishakha delighted and rejoiced in Bhikkhuni Dhammadina's birth. Then he asked her a further question. Lady, origin of identity. Origin of identity is said. What is called the original identity? उसका उद्गमन कैसे होता है? जो identity है उसका उद्गमन कैसे होता है? Means उसका शुरुआत कैसे होता है? Friend Vaishakha, craving which brings a renewal of being. Is accompanied by delight and lust, and delights in this and that. That is craving for sensual pleasures, craving for being, craving for non-being. This is called the origin of identity. तो वो कहते हैं कि जो आपका जो आशक्ति है, जो तन्हा है, वो जो है पुनर्जन्म का स्रोत बनता है, और वो जो है तन्हा के हिसाब से यहाँ और वहाँ पे आप उसका डिलाइट मीन्स आप उसका आनंद उठाते हैं, और लोभ करते हैं, लस्ट मीन्स आप लोभ करते हैं। तो क्योंकि तन्हा के हिसाब से आपका खुशी भी आती है और लोभ भी आता है, और वो यहाँ और वहाँ पे वो अपने चीज़ों में ये एक या दूसरे चीज़ों में अपना खुशी वो पाता है और या देखता है। एंड क्रेविंग फॉर, और वो क्या करता है कि वो सेंशुअल प्लेजर्स मीन्स जो जो भी आपका सेंस है, जो आपके आँख का मीन्स अच्छी चीज़ देखना है, अच्छा सुनना है, अच्छा सूंघना है, अच्छा खाना है, अच्छा कोई कपड़ा पहनना है, मीन्स आपका स्किन त्वचा को अच्छा लगे, या अच्छा कुछ मीन्स मूवी देखना है वैसा है आपका मन के लिए, तो वो सारा सेंशुअल प्लेजर्स है। और क्रेविंग फॉर बींग, क्रेविंग फॉर बींग मीन्स आपको कोई दूसरे कोई रूप पे अंदर आपको ये लोभ रहता है कि मैं एक राजा बन जाऊं, या मैं एक मैं देवलोक में या राजा बन जाऊं, या मैं एक ये बन जाऊं पॉलिटिशियन बन जाऊं, या पीएम बन जाऊं, या जो भी है आपका लोभ रहता है कुछ भी बनने का। और एक है लोभ रहता है नॉन बी, नॉन बी का मतलब है, क्रेविंग फॉर नॉन बी का मतलब है कि आपका जो अस्तित्व है ख़त्म हो जाए, वैसा भी आपका ये रहता है। तो इसी हिसाब से बहुत लोग आत्महत्या करते हैं क्योंकि वो अपना अस्तित्व मिटाना चाहते हैं, तो वो भी एक मूलभूत एक हमारा ये है क्रेविंग या तन्हा है। सो वन ऑफ द थिंग्स ऑफ बिकमिंग ए नॉन बीइंग इज दैट ट्राइंग टू इलिमिनेट दिस थिंग, एंड दैट इज द रीजन सुसाइड इज सो प्रेवेलेंट, बिकॉज इट्स ए बेसिक ह्यूमन टेंडेंसी टू kind of eliminate this being, but that is something not possible in practice, because what you can eliminate is this physical body which was anyway impermanent, but you cannot stop this flow of consciousness, because the consciousness will still go on without the body. So that is an important this thing. And one of the things about over here you have to notice this, that one of the craving which is there of being is also there in anagami. That stage, which is the third stage before Arahant, that is one of the reasons why rebirth happens in the Brahmaloka, because that craving he still clings on to. So, एक चीज आपको ध्यान रखना है कि जो अनागामी है उनको भी ये कुछ बनने का ऐसा जो आशक्ति है या तन्हा है वो रहता है, इसलिए वो ब्रह्मलोक में के लिए जाते हैं, और उस हिसाब से वो तब अरहंत नहीं होते, क्योंकि हर एक जो आपकी तन्हा है उसे छोड़ना है, तभी आप पूरी तरह से मुक्त हो सकते हैं। लेडी, सीसेशन ऑफ आइडेंटिटी, सीसेशन ऑफ आइडेंटिटी इज सेड, व्हाट इज कॉल्ड द सीसेशन ऑफ आइडेंटिटी, ये जो आइडेंटिटी है उसका खत्म कैसे होगा, तो वो पूछ रहे हैं। फ्रेंड वैशाखा, इट इज द रिमाइंडरनेस फेडिंग अवे एंड सीजिंग द गिविंग अप, रिलिंक्विशिंग, लेटिंग गो एंड रिजेक्टिंग ऑफ दिस ऑफ दैट सेम क्रेविंग। सो यहाँ पे उनको वो बोलते हैं कि जो आपका भी जो भी आपका जो तन्हा है उसको पूरी तरह से आपको मिटाना है। सो नाउ आई अभी आपका जो कोई भी जो वहाँ पे है, जहाँ पे हम बोलते हैं कि आप उपेक्षा में हैं, तो उपेक्षा में जब मैं आपको बात करता हूँ तो मैं यही सलाह देता हूँ कि आपको हर एक चीज जो है आपको जाने देना है, जाने देना है, जाने देना है। तो ये वही चीज आपको बोलते हैं, वो क्या बोलते हैं कि रिमाइंडरलेस फेडिंग अवे एंड सीजिंग, गिविंग अप, रिलिंक्विशिंग, लेटिंग गो, रिजेक्टिंग ऑफ द सेम क्रेविंग। मीन्स आपको कोई भी चीज आती है उसको जाने देना है। सो दिस इज द सेम एडवाइस वी गिव टू पीपल हु आर इन हायर स्टेट्स ऑफ माइंड और इन इक्वानिमिटी, दैट टू रिलिंक्विश एवरीथिंग, लेट गो ऑफ एवरीथिंग। Even if there is very subtle things which are coming up, you let go, let go, let go. So this is the from the start you are letting go, but in the higher jhanas you are letting go of the finer things which are very minute, which are very kind of little, but they kind of still tug you back and forth. So those are the things which you have to let go, let go. And you have to reminderless when everything has gone and there is nothing coming back, that is the time you have reached your awakening. That is called the cessation of identity by the Blessed One. Lady, the way leading to the cessation of identity, the way leading to the cessation of identity is said. What is called the way leading to the cessation of identity by the Blessed One? Friend Vaishakha, it is just this noble eightfold path, that is, I will tell you, there are two ways of doing this. This is the standard way, and I will tell you what my teacher Bhante Vimalaramji has translated into. Okay, so this is the eightfold path. The normal way it is translated is right view, right intention, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. So Bhante Vimalaramji does not like the word right, so he has used the word harmonious. Harmonious. So then the harmonious means it should be in balance. It is not right or wrong, but it is about balance. And balance is something which is there in the central part of the Buddha's teaching. So ये जो आपका अष्टांगिक जो आठ वो बोलते हैं ना, आठ अंग वाला जो मार्ग है, जो एट फोल्ड पाथ, वही है जो आपको इसके जो निब्बाना के तरफ ले जाता है। तो ये जो आइडेंटिटी है उसका अंत होने के लिए आपको एट फोल्ड पाथ का करना चाहिए। तो अभी ये अंग्रेजी में जो है राइट बोलते हैं, सम्मा का मतलब है बैलेंस। तो हमारे उसको हारमोनियस का नाम देते हैं। तो हारमोनियस view becomes harmonious perspective. That is the what perspective you are seeing this thing. So harmonious perspective, then harmonious thought becomes the right thought becomes harmonious imaging. Then right speech becomes harmonious communication. How you are communicating to yourself and to others, what comes up to you and how you communicate. Right action becomes harmonious movement. So how is your movement of your mind, you know, and you have the correct movement of this mind. So in the meditation sense, he is bringing this eightfold mind in line with the meditation. Right action, then right livelihood. The life livelihood is changed to harmonious lifestyle. So how you live your life? You live your life with the wholesome perspective and give up the unwholesome. So that is how you live your life. Normally in livelihood it is said that you don't deal in arms, you don't deal in poison, you don't deal in slaves. But the monks who he taught were not anyways going to deal with that. So this is a teaching for your life, saying that how you balance wholesome and unwholesome and live a life, the lifestyle how you are living, that has to be done. Then right effort becomes right practice. The practice which you are doing is recognizing, releasing, relaxing, re-smiling, returning and repeating when needed. So that 6R is the right practice, harmonious practice. Then right mindfulness becomes right observation. So how to observe your mind's attention is moving from one thing to another, and how it is impersonal, how it is linked to the dependent origination. So that becomes harmonious observation. Right mindfulness becomes concentration becomes right collectedness. So that is how your mind comes and can be collected at one point of object of your meditation. So how your mind can view that. So यहाँ पे अभी अष्टांग विधि का मार्ग जो है अंग्रेजी के अंदर ज़्यादा महत्व है, क्योंकि जो अंग्रेजी का अनुवाद है वो अलग था, तो हमारे पंडित जी ने अंग्रेजी का अलग अनुवाद अलग किया है. मगर आप अगर हिंदी में देखें तो उसका जो अनुवाद है वो आपको मैं बताता हूँ हिंदी में किस तरह से हमें मेडिटेशन के हिसाब से हमें सोचना चाहिए. तो उसे क्या बोलते हैं, सम्मा दृष्टि. तो क्या किस तरह से हम देखते हैं हर चीज़ को, उसका पहला मार्ग है. पहले अगर सम्मा दृष्टि है, फिर दूसरा है सम्मा संकल्प. संकल्प का मतलब है आपका संकल्प क्या है, या आपका जो क्या बोलते हैं, आप किस तरह से चीज़ों को देखते हैं, कौन सा आप चित्र आप बनाते हैं. मीन्स आप तो अगर समझो कोई चीज़ अगर होती है समझो, तो आप उसका ये गलत चित्र निकालते हैं या सही चित्र निकालते हैं, कि आप पॉजिटिव आप सोचते हैं या आप नेगेटिव सोचते हैं, तो वो आप किस तरह से अपना चित्र या संकल्प निकालते हैं. फिर है सम्मा वाचा. तो सम्मा वाचा मीन्स आपका किस तरह से आपके साथ में किस तरह से आपका कम्युनिकेशन है, और आप दूसरे के साथ में किस तरह से आप कम्युनिकेशन कर रहे हैं, तो वो आपको देखना है. फिर है सम्मा आज कामंता. कामंता मीन्स आपका आप किस तरह से ये काम कर रहा है, कार्य कर रहा है, उसे देखना है. जैसे आपका मन जो है किस तरह से एक जगह से दूसरी जगह जाता है, वो कार्य किस तरह कर रहा है मन का, वो हमें देखना है. अगर वो एक दूसरी जगह जाता है वो अपने आप ही जाता है, तो अव्यक्ति व्यक्तिगत है. और किस तरह से पतिजा समुपदा का आप ज्ञान ले सकते हैं उसमें से, तो वो आपको देखना है. सम्मा आजीवा का मतलब है आप अपना जीवन किस तरह से निकालते हैं. आप अपना जीवन कोई अच्छी चीज़ को देख के निकालते हैं, कि आप बुरी चीज़ों पे आपका ध्यान रखते हैं, तो उसका वो आपको ध्यान रखना है. फिर सम्मा क्या है, सम्मा स्मृति. तो वो है आपका जो आपका जो हम प्रैक्टिस कर रहे हैं, जो आप कार्य कर रहे हैं, जो शिक्षा हम लोग कहते हैं अंग्रेजी में, या आप सही प्रयास जो कर रहे हैं उसे बोलते हैं. जहाँ पे आपको पहचानना है, जाने देना है, रिलैक्स करना है, स्माइल करना है, फिर वापस अपने कल्याण मित्र या जो भी आप कर रहे हैं ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ मेडिटेशन पे आना है, और आपको फिर ये रिपीट करना है जब आपको ज़रूरत है. फिर आपका सम्मा समाधि. तो सम्मा समाधि में जो है आपका जो मन है एकाग्र हो, एकाग्रता, तो वो एकाग्रता आपको आनी चाहिए. मीन्स आपका मन जो है, जो भी आप आपका जो ध्येय है, ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ मेडिटेशन है, जो भी ध्येय है उसके ऊपर मन टिकना चाहिए, वो आपका ये कार्य करना चाहिए. तो उस तरह से ये अष्टांगिका का मार्ग जो है वो आपको निब्बाना के ओर लेके जाता है. तो ये आपको यहाँ पे कहा गया है. सो वी हैव मोर इन्फॉर्मेशन ऑल्सो, सो वील कंटिन्यू. Lady, is that clinging the same as the five aggregates when affected by clinging? Is the clinging something apart from the five aggregates affected by clinging? Friend Vaishaka, that clinging is neither the same as the as these five aggregates affected by clinging, nor is clinging something apart from the five aggregates when affected by clinging. It is the desire lust in regard to the five aggregates affected by clinging, that is the clinging in them. So, ये जो पांच खंड है हमारे, वो पांच खंड और जो आपका जो चिपकाव है वो अलग है या एक ही है? तो उन्होंने बोला वो एक हिसाब से अलग है, और एक हिसाब से जब आपका जो आप चिपकाव पैदा कर रहे हैं तभी वो चीज आती है. सो दिस इज बेस्ड ऑन saying that it is the desire and lust in regard to the five aggregates affected by clinging, that is the clinging there. So when you are desiring and clinging to this, that is the time you are creating that is the part of the clinging in the five aggregates. But as an arahant, arahant does not cling to anything. So at the time, they still have this five aggregates, the Arahant. Arahant does not dissolve when he gets awakened. So the point is that those five aggregates, when it is linked to it, that it will give you dukkha, it will give you pain and suffering. But when it is not clinged to, it will not give you suffering. तो ये ऐसा कहा जाता है जब आप उसको आशक्ति रखते हैं अपने जो भी खंड है उसके ऊपर, तभी आपको वो दुख दे सकता है। जैसे अरहंत है, अरहंत का भी शरीर है और पांच खंड है, तो उसको कोई दुख नहीं हो सकता। क्यों नहीं हो सकता? क्योंकि उसको चिपकाव पैदा नहीं करता अरहंत। इसी हिसाब से वहाँ पे उसका वो दुख ये पैदा नहीं कर सकता। तो जहाँ पे भी आप चिपकाव पैदा करते हैं, वहीं पे आप दुख पैदा करते हैं। सो वेयरएवर यू क्लिंग and hold on to that time you develop the pain. Lady, how does identity view come to be? Here friend Vaishakha, an untaught ordinary person who has no regard for noble words and is unskilled and undisciplined in their dhamma, who has no regard to true men and is unskilled and undisciplined in their dhamma, regards material form as self or self as possessed of material form or material form as in self or self as in material form. He regards feeling as self, or self as possessed of feeling, or feeling as in self, or self in the feeling. So these are ways of identity. That is, you have considered that this form is mine, this is me, this is myself. So that is how you create the identity. ये बोल आप अगर जब ये बोलते हैं कि ये शरीर मेरा है, ये मैं हूँ, तब आप इसका जो है आइडेंटिटी क्रिएट करते हैं या आपका जो व्यक्तिगत जो है उसे बनाते हैं। क्योंकि आप जो जो भी चीज़ है उसे आप समझते हैं कि ये मैं हूँ। तो अगर आप ये समझते हैं कि शरीर मैं हूँ तो आप इसका ये करेंगे। अगर ये आप समझते हैं कि ये वेदना मैं हूँ तो उसको आप अपना आइडेंटिटी बनाएंगे। या आप समझते हैं कि इसका जो पर्सपेक्टिव है या दृष्टिकोण देखने का है वो मैं हूँ, या मैं ये जो विचार आ रहा है ये विचार मैं हूँ। जैसे मैंने विचारों के बारे में बहुत बार कहा, विचार मैं हूँ। या आप मानते हैं कि ये विज्ञान है, ये विज्ञान मैं हूँ, तब आप उसको एक व्यक्तिगत बनाते हैं इसको। सो ये सारे जो चीज़ें हैं उसके बारे में बताते हैं। And how does identity view not come to be? So here Vaishakha, a well-taught noble disciplined who has regard for noble ones and is skilled and disciplined in the dhamma, who has regard for true men and is skilled and disciplined in the dhamma, does not regard material form as self or self as possessed of material form or of material form as self or self as in material form. He does not regard feeling, perception, formations and consciousness. So he does not regard anything as his own self. So that is because he is learning the correct dhamma, the correct teaching of the Buddha, of the noble ones. जब वो आर्य सत्य का जो सीखता है तब वो अपने आप को, वो नहीं कहता कि शरीर मैं हूँ या ये वेदना मैं हूँ या ये जो दृष्टिकोण मैं हूँ या ये सोच मैं हूँ या ये जो विज्ञान है ये मैं हूँ, तो वो छोड़ देता है जब वो सही जो शिक्षा पढ़ता है और सही लोगों के साथ में संबंध रखता है, तब आपको ये सारी चीज़ें आप छोड़ते हैं। Lady, what is the Noble Eightfold Path? Friend Vaishakha, it is just this Noble Eightfold Path, that is harmonious perspective, harmonious imaging, harmonious communication, harmonious movement, harmonious lifestyle, harmonious practice, harmonious observation and harmonious collectedness. These are the Eightfold Path. तो ये पूछते हैं कि अष्टांग का मार्ग क्या है, तो वो यही अष्टांग का मार्ग का जो हमने बताया वही आठ अंग है। लेडी, इज द एटफोल्ड पाथ कंडीशन और अनकंडीशन? फ्रेंड वैशाखा, द एटफोल्ड पाथ इज कंडीशन। सो द कंडीशन मीन्स दैट एनीथिंग विच कम्स टुगेदर एंड फॉर्म समथिंग इज कंडीशन। सो ये पूछते हैं कि जो अष्टांगी का मार्ग है उसे कंडीशन है या नहीं। कंडीशन का मतलब क्या होता है? जो भी चीज़ बनती है, दो चीज़ों का मिलन मिश्रण से बनती है, वो चीज़ जो है कंडीशन देती है। तो ये बोलते हैं कि अष्टांगी का मार्ग भी है जो भी, वो भी कंडीशन ही है। और एक ही चीज जो अनकंडीशन है वो क्या है, निब्बाना। निब्बाना में आपको कोई चीज का बनावट नहीं है उसमें, तो वही एक चीज है जिसकी बनावट नहीं है, बनावट रहित चीज जो है वही है, उसको आप सोच के आप समझ नहीं सकते क्योंकि आपके जो भी संपर्क में आए हैं वो बनावट की है। सो कंडीशन थिंग्स आर व्हाट वी डील विद, दैट इज द रीजन बाई थॉट, थॉट इज ऑल्सो कंडीशन, वी कैन नॉट अंडरस्टैंड वॉट इज अनकंडीशन। So, एक फॉर्म ऑफ थॉट इज ऑल्सो कंडीशन बट इट लीड्स टू द अनकंडीशन, दैट इज निब्बाना और अवेकनिंग। लेडी आर द थ्री एग्रीगेट्स इंक्लूडेड बाय द एट फोल्ड नोबल पाथ, और इज द एट फोल्ड नोबल पाथ इंक्लूडेड बाय द थ्री एग्रीगेट्स? द थ्री एग्रीगेट्स आर नॉट इंक्लूडेड बाय द एट फोल्ड नोबल पाथ फ्रेंड रिशाखा, बट द एट फोल्ड नोबल पाथ इज इंक्लूडेड बाय द थ्री एग्रीगेट्स। So the three aggregates are right speech, right action, and right livelihood. So these states are included in the aggregate of virtue. So ये जो है ना सील समाधि पर्याय के बारे में पूछ रहे हैं अभी कि अभी ये जो तीन सील समाधि पर्याय तीन aggregates हैं जो वो किस तरह से अष्टांगिका मार्ग से जुड़े हुए हैं। So so harmonious communication, harmonious movement and harmonious lifestyle, these states are included in aggregate of virtue. Virtue is the sila, the percepts we take is to maintain the virtue, right? Harmonious practice, harmonious observation and harmonious collectedness, these states are included in the aggregate of concentration or collectedness, harmonious perspective, harmonious imaging, harmonious these are included in the aggregate of wisdom. Wisdom is the faculty where we learn from our this thing, practice and see what is the reality, and by seeing the reality we see the escape from it. So that is the part of wisdom. तो यहाँ पे शील समाधि और पन्या के अंदर जो है तीनों अष्टांगिकी का मार्ग समाते हैं उस तरह से बताया गया है। तो जो आपका तीन चीज है, सम्मा वाचा, सम्मा कम्मन्त और सम्मा आजीवा, जो है वो आपका शील में आ जाता है। जो हम लोग सुबह आप ये शील आपको देते हैं अठशील या पंचशील जो भी आप लेंगे घर पे जाके, और जो है सम्मा व्यायाम, सम्मा सती और सम्मा समाधि, ये जो तीन चीज है वो आपका कॉन्सेंट्रेशन या एकाग्रता में आ जाती है। फिर सम्मा सम्मा दिट्ठी और सम्मा कम्मन्त, सम्मा क्या है सॉरी सम्मा संकप्पा, सम्मा संकप्पा दोनों जो चीज है वो पन्या के अंदर आती है। तो उस तरह से अष्टांगिक का मार्ग इस तीनों के अंदर साथ में मिल जाती है। लेडी व्हाट इज कनेक्टेडनेस, व्हाट इज द बेसिस ऑफ कनेक्टेडनेस, व्हाट इज द इक्विपमेंट ऑफ कनेक्टेडनेस, व्हाट इज द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ कनेक्टेडनेस, यूनिफिकेशन ऑफ माइंड फ्रेंड इशाका इज कनेक्टेडनेस। तो यूनिफिकेशन ऑफ माइंड इज ब्रिंगिंग द माइंड टू वन एम और ऑब्जेक्टिव। सो योर ऑब्जेक्टिव इज टू सेंड method to your switcher friend that you have to have your mind over that. If your objective is to send it into direction, that should be there. If you are just watching your mind, if you are in a quiet mind, then just watching your mind should be your this thing. So your ability to be there is this collectedness. So आपका जो एकाग्रता है वो एकाग्रता आपको बताया जाता है कि आपका एकाग्रता के लिए क्या चाहिए। तो उन्होंने पहले चीज क्या बताया, एकाग्रता के लिए आपका मन जो है किसी भी चीज में टिकना चाहिए। तो अगर हम बताते हैं कि आपको आपको अपने कल्याण मित्र को मेहता भेजना है तो उसके ऊपर आपका मन टिकना चाहिए। अगर हम बताते हैं कि दिशाओं में आपको भेजो आपका मेहता सामने पीछे ऊपर नीचे छह दिशाओं, तो आपका मन उसमें टिकना चाहिए। और अगर हम बताते हैं कि आपका मन को से मन को देखो, तो आपको मन से मन को देखने के आपको शक्ति देनी चाहिए। तो वो आपका यहाँ पे पहले आता है। The four foundation of mindfulness are the basis of collectedness. जो आपको फोर फाउंडेशन आपको बताया गया है, चार तरीके के आपको जो मेडिटेशन करना है, जो हमने पहले आपको बताया गया है, एक दो सूत्र में आपको पहले हमने बताया है। द फोर काइंड्स ऑफ स्ट्राइविंग आर द इक्विपमेंट ऑफ कॉन्सेंट्रेशन, मीन्स सात चार ऐसे चीज़ें जिससे आप ये कर सकते हैं आपका जो हम यहाँ पे फोर काइंड ऑफ स्ट्राइविंग जो बताते हैं इज सिक्स फोर्ड पाथ इज द फोर काइंड ऑफ स्ट्राइविंग विच वी काइंड ऑफ ब्रेक इट डाउन इनटू ए काइंड ऑफ इजी फॉर्मूला दैट इज रिकॉग्नाइज एंड रिलीज रिलैक्स रिस्माइल रिटर्न एंड रिपीट। सो वो जो हम चार जो आपके जो चीज़ आपको करना चाहिए वो हम सिक्स आर की तरह बताते हैं, जैसे आपको सही प्रयास की तरह बताते हैं, जैसे आपको पहचानना है, छोड़ देना है, रिलैक्स करना है, स्माइल करना है, वापस आना है, वो सही प्रयास आपको चाहिए। आपको किसी चीज़ पे टिका रहना चाहिए, योर माइंड शुड बी देयर ऑन समथिंग एंड यू विल बी एबल टू डू द राइट एफर्ट। द रिपीटेशन, द रिपीटेशन, रिपीटेशन का मतलब क्या है कि आप बार बार वही करना है, आप एक बार करके नहीं हुआ तो आपको हताश नहीं होना है, यू हैव टू रिपीट दिस। डेवलपमेंट एंड कल्टिवेशन ऑफ दिस सेम स्टेज इज द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ कॉन्सेंट्रेशन देयर और कलेक्टेडनेस देयर। सो आपको बार बार करना है, उसको आपको आगे बढ़ाना है, डेवलप करना है और उसको कल्टिवेट करना है, मीन्स उसका जैसे उपचारते हैं, जैसे कोई हम धान उपजाते हैं तो क्या है, हम बीज डालते हैं, उसके अंदर खाद डालते हैं, उसके अंदर पानी डालते हैं, उसके उसके लिए फिर हम रुकते हैं और उसकी देखभाल करते हैं, उस तरह से आपको उसको उपजाना है। हाउ वी काइंड ऑफ व्हेन वी प्लांट समथिंग वी हैव टू पुट वाटर मैन्योर एंड देन टेक केयर ऑफ इट एंड काइंड ऑफ प्रोटेक्ट इट, दैट इज़ हाउ वी हैव टू प्रोटेक्ट एंड डेवलप अवर माइंड फुलनेस, दैट इज वॉट इट इज सेइंग, और द राइट एफर्ट ऑल्सो, और वॉट वी आर सेइंग एज सिक्स आर, वी हैव टू काइंड ऑफ हैव दिस इन ए, इट कैन नॉट बी, इट हैज टू हैव द स्ट्राइविंग रिपीटेशन एंड डेवलपमेंट एंड कल्टिवेशन, दोज क्वालिटीज आर टू बी डेवलप्ड। लेडी हाउ मेनी फाउंडेशंस आर देयर, देर आर दिस थ्री फाउंडेशंस फ्रेंड, बॉडीली फॉर्मेशंस, हाउ मेनी फॉर्मेशंस आर देयर, शंखार आ कितने तरह के हैं, तो बॉडीली फॉर्मेशन, वर्बल फॉर्मेशन एंड मेंटल फॉर्मेशन, तो शंखारा तीन का देखें कि आपका जो शरीर है बॉडीली फॉर्मेशन और वर्बल फॉर्मेशन जो वाचा का आपका है, और तीसरा है मेंटल जो भी आपका ये दिमाग में या आता है। तो आपका जो भी आप बोल सकते हैं बॉडीली फॉर्मेशन भी आपका शरीर है, जो भी आप बोलते हैं वो वाचा है, और जो भी आप सोचते हैं जैसे विचार है उसको विचार को बोल सकते हैं कि मेंटल फॉर्मेशन। बट लेडी वॉट इज बॉडीली फॉर्मेशन, वॉट इज द वर्बल फॉर्मेशन, वॉट इज द मेंटल फॉर्मेशन, इन ब्रीदिंग एंड आउट ब्रीदिंग फ्रेंड एंड विशाखा आर द बॉडीली फॉर्मेशन, इनिशियल थॉट एंड सस्टेन थॉट आर द वर्बल फॉर्मेशन, परसेप्शन एंड आर द मेंटल फॉर्मेशन। जो आप सांस अंदर लेते हैं और बाहर करते हैं वो काया का काया के साथ जुड़ा हुआ है, जो आपका जो आपका विचार आता है, पहले विचार आता है और फिर आप वो उस विचार पे टिकते हैं, मीन्स जो विचार चलता है वो दो जो विचारों के हैं वो आपको वाचा के साथ में जुड़े हुए हैं, और जो आपका जो कोई चीज़ आप देखते हैं और उसका महसूस करते हैं, मीन्स जो वेदना है और आपका दृष्टिकोण है वो जो है वो मन के साथ में जुड़ा हुआ है, वो इस तरह से तीनों जुड़े हुए हैं। बट लेडी वाई आर इन ब्रीदिंग एंड आउट ब्रीदिंग द बॉडीली फॉर्मेशन, जो श्वास लेना अंदर वो क्यों शरीर के साथ जुड़ा है, वाई आर इनिशियल थॉट एंड सस्टेन थॉट द वर्बल फॉर्मेशन, जो आपका सोच है वो आपका वाचा के साथ में क्यों जुड़ा हुआ है, वाई इज परसेप्शन एंड फीलिंग द मेंटल फॉर्मेशन, क्यों आपका जो दृष्टिकोण है और आपका जो वेदना है वो मन के साथ जुड़ी है। फ्रेंड वैशाखा इन ब्रीदिंग एंड आउट ब्रीदिंग आर बॉडीली, दीज आर स्टेट्स बाउंड अप विद द बॉडी, दैट इज व्हाई इट इज ब्रीदिंग, इन ब्रीदिंग एंड आउट ब्रीदिंग आर बॉडीली फॉर्मेशन, क्योंकि आपका श्वास अंदर लेना और बाहर लेना शरीर के साथ जुड़ा हुआ है, इसके हिसाब से इसे शरीर से जोड़ रहता है। फर्स्ट वन अप्लाइज, फर्स्ट वन हैज इनिशियल थॉट एंड देन सस्टेन्स द थॉट। सो पहले आपको पहले एक विचार आता है और उस विचार के ऊपर आपको ध्यान देते हैं, एंड सब्सिक्वेंटली वन ब्रेक्स आउट इन टू स्पीच, उसके बाद वो आप बात करते हैं। तो पहले विचार आता है, उसके बाद आप उसका बात करते हैं। जैसे आपको कोई विचार आया कि ये जो फूल है बहुत खूबसूरत है, पहले वो विचार आएगा, फिर आप बोलेंगे ये फूल तो बहुत खूबसूरत है। फर्स्ट यू विल हैव द थॉट एंड देन द स्पीच, यू विल ब्रेक आउट इन स्पीच। सो फर्स्ट यू मे हैव अ थॉट ऑफ दिस इज अ वेरी ब्यूटीफुल फ्लावर, एंड देन यू विल से टू समबडी से दिस इज अ वेरी ब्यूटीफुल फ्लावर, बट दैट थॉट हैड कम फर्स्ट, देन यू ब्रेक आउट इन स्पीच। सो दैट इज द रीजन दिस इज एसोसिएटेड विद द स्पीच थिंग। Perception and feeling are mental. These are still bound up with the mind. That is why perception and feeling are mental. Because when we perceive and when we have the feeling, that are seen by the mind. That is the reason those states are bound by the mind. जब हम आपको कोई किसी का दृष्टिकोण है वो देखते हैं, या आप वेदना होती है तो वो मन से ही हम देखते हैं, तो इसलिए वो मन के साथ में जुड़ी हुई है। Lady, how does the attainment of the cessation of perception and feeling come to be? So now, वो अभी निरोध समापत्ति के बारे में पूछ रहे हैं कि how does the cessation of perception and feeling come to be? It is asking about the cessation part, which we few people I have discussed with over here. Friend Vaishakha, when a student is attaining the cessation of perception and feeling, it does not occur to him, I shall attain the cessation of perception and feeling. So first he does not know, and or I am attaining the cessation of perception and feeling, means when it is happening he does not know, or I have attained the cessation of perception and feeling, so he does not know when he is in cessation, but rather the mind has previously been developed in such a way that it leads to that state, means you are in a quiet mind for a while, that is you are in balance, at that time the cessation happens, and when you come out of cessation only then you know. So it is like when I gave an example, I think of the light going, but it is kind of like a reverse thing about the light going. We know that the light has gone, but we come to know when the light has come back, we know the light had gone. So that is the kind of the right simile for this, because at that moment it is happening, we are not aware of this happening. But when we come back, then we know that we had an experience, that everything had shut down. That is the time we know. So, यहाँ पे ये कहा जाता है कि जब आपका ये जो निरोध समापत्ति हो रही है, उससे पहले आपको पता नहीं चलता कि वो होगी, जब हो रही है तभी नहीं पता चलता, जब आप निरोध समापत्ति में हैं तब पता नहीं चलता, जब आप वापस आते हैं तभी आपको पता चलता है। जैसे आपकी लाइट गई यहाँ पे, तो सब अंधेरा हो गया तो आपको तुरंत पता चला, मगर अगर आपको मैं ऐसा बोलूंगा आप लाइट आने के बाद में आपको पता चलेगा अरे लाइट गई थी, तो उस तरह का आपको अनुभव होगा, तो उस अनुभव को आपको बराबर समझना है। रेडी, हाउ डज इमर्जेंस फ्रॉम द अटेनमेंट ऑफ सिचुएशन और परसेप्शन एंड फीलिंग कम टू बी? फ्रेंड वैशाखा, व्हेन ए स्टूडेंट इज इमर्जिंग फ्रॉम द अटेनमेंट ऑफ द cessation of perception and feeling, it does not occur to him, I shall emerge from the attainment of cessation of perception and feeling, or I am emerging from the attainment of the cessation of perception or feeling, or I have emerged from the attainment of cessation of perception and feeling, but rather his mind has previously developed in such a way that it leads him to that state. So what is the development of mind for him to come back is the practice of determinations which I have given you previously. That is, when you are determining that at this point of time you will come back, so when you have developed this determination, then you can that has been developed by you, so you take a determination, I'll be in cessation for 30 minutes, then after 30 minutes you emerge from the cessation. So that is the prior development. So when coming back also you are not having any consciousness or feeling, so when you come back is because you have already determined, or there are by default you have a development, or the causes and conditions are such that when you go into cessation you come back after certain amount of time. So यहाँ पे वापस निर्धारण समापत्ति से आएंगे तभी भी आपको पता नहीं रहता है, क्योंकि वहाँ पे विन्यास नहीं है आपका, तो आप वापस आ जाते हैं जब आते हैं, जब क्योंकि आपने पहले उसकी तैयारी की है। वो तैयारी क्या है? जो अधिष्ठान की तैयारी मैंने दी थी, आप चार बजे अगर उठना है तो आप पहले सोते हो और बोले कि मैं 4 बजे उठता हूँ, तो जब आप 4 बजे उठते हैं फिर आप या बोले कि मैं 5 बजे उठता हूँ, तो फिर 5 बजे अगर उठे तो फिर बोले कि 5:02 को उठता हूँ, तो फिर उस तरह से हर रोज आप अपना ये करते हैं, अड्डी ठान लेते हैं और आपका अड्डी ठान आपका प्रबल बनाते हैं। और फिर एक दूसरा अड्डी ठान हमने दिया था कि आप जब उठेंगे तो आप मुस्कुराते हुए उठेंगे, जब भी आप सोते हैं तो आपको ये अड्डी ठान करना है कि आप जब उठेंगे मुस्कुराते उठेंगे। तो वो जो आपका ट्रेनिंग है यहाँ पे काम आता है जब आपको इससे बाहर आना है निरोधा समापत्ति से, जब अगर आप बोल सकते हैं कि मैं निरोधा समापत्ति में बैठूंगा और वापस आऊंगा, तो तब उसने आ सकते हैं। और ये कौन बैठ सकता है, जो अनागामी का फल जिसे पाया हुआ है वो ये कर सकता है। अभी यहाँ पे शायद कोई नहीं है होगा वो करने वाला, मगर जो अनागामी का फल जो प्राप्त कर चुका है वो ऐसा कर सकता है। एंड दिस इज पॉसिबल बाय वन हु हैज अटेन्ड द फ्रूइशन ऑफ अनागामी नॉन रिटर्नर द थर्ड दिस थिंग, सो कैन गो एज पर डिटर्मिनेशन इनटू सीसेशन एंड कैन कम बैक फ्रॉम द सीसेशन। सो दैट इज द काइंड ऑफ मिनिमम डेवलपमेंट ऑफ माइंड इज रिक्वायर्ड टू गो इनटू सीसेशन ऑन विल। So that is the word. Maybe when a bhikkhu or a student is emerging from the attainment of the cessation of perception and feeling, which state arises first in him? The bodily formation, verbal formation, or the mental formation? Friend Vishaka, when a student is emerging from the attainment of the cessation of perception and feeling, first the mental formation arises, then the bodily formation, then the verbal formation. तो ये बोलते हैं निरोधा समापत्ति के वापस आने के क्या पहले होता है, तो पहले आपका जो है जो है बॉडी फॉर्मेशन मीन्स शरीर का जो है वो चीज़ आती है पहले, फिर उसके बाद में वाचा का आता है, उसके बाद में आपका जो विचार का जो है मेंटल फॉर्मेशन वो वापस चालू होता है। Lady, when a student has emerged from the attainment of cessation of perception and feeling, how many kinds of contact touch him? So, वो बोलते हैं कि जब वो वापस आता है निरोधा समापत्ति से तो क्या क्या चीज़ें उसे छूती है या स्पर्श है, स्पर्श क्या होता है? Friend Vishaka, when a student has emerged from the attainment of the cessation of perception and feeling, three kinds of contact touch him. Voidless contact, signless contact and desireless contact. तो तीन चीज़ों का स्पर्श होता है, एक है जो वॉइड वॉइडनेस मीन्स शून्यता का जो स्पर्श होता है, साइनलेस मीन्स चिन्ह रहित स्पर्श होता है, और तीसरा जो है डिजायरलेस कॉन्टैक्ट मीन्स उसके अंदर कोई जात का तन्हा नहीं है, वैसे चीज़ का आपको स्पर्श होता है। लेडी, व्हेन ए भिक्खु स्टूडेंट हैज इमर्ज फ्रॉम द अटेनमेंट ऑफ द सेसेशन ऑफ परसेप्शन एंड फीलिंग, टू व्हाट डज हिज माइंड इंक्लाइन टू, व्हाट डज इट लीड to what does it tend means nirodha samapatti aane ke baad mein man kis tarah jhukta hai. Friend Vishaka, when a student has emerged from the attainment of the cessation of perception and feeling, his mind inclines to seclusion, leans to seclusion, tends to seclusion. Jab wo nirodha samapatti se wapas aata hai to wo ekant ki taraf uska man mudta hai. So when you come out of this thing, you are more likely to have a calm mind and joy. और उसके बाद में आपको बहुत खुशी का भी एहसास होता है और आपका जो भी दृष्टि है वो बहुत तेज हो जाती है, तो आपका रंग है आप बहुत अच्छी तरह से वो रंग को पहचान सकते हैं, अगर हरा है तो बहुत अच्छी तरह हरा दिखेगा, लाल है तो बहुत अच्छा लाल दिखेगा, उस तरह से आपका जो इंद्रिया है भी है वो तीव्र हो जाती है, मीन्स योर ऑर्गन्स एंड फैकल्टीज ऑल्सो आर ब्राइट एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम। लेडी, हाउ मेनी काइंड्स ऑफ फीलिंग आर देयर? फ्रेंड वैशाखा, देयर आर थ्री काइंड्स ऑफ फीलिंग, प्लेजेंट फीलिंग, पेनफुल फीलिंग एंड नीदर पेनफुल और प्लेजेंट फीलिंग। कैसे तीन तरह के वेदना है, तो सुखद वेदना है, दुखद वेदना है, असुखद अदुखद वेदना है। बट लेडी, वॉट इज प्लेजेंट फीलिंग, वॉट इज पेनफुल फीलिंग, वॉट इज नीदर पेनफुल और प्लेजेंट फीलिंग? सो ये वेदना क्या है? फ्रेंड वैशाखा, वॉट एवर इज फेल्ट बॉडिली और मेंटली एज प्लेजेंट एंड सूदिंग इज प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. जो भी आपको मन में या आपके शरीर के अंदर आपको अच्छा लगता है वो चीज है सुखद वेदना. वॉट एवर इज फेल्ट बॉडली और मेंटली एज पेनफुल और एंड हर्टिंग इज पेनफुल फीलिंग. जो भी मन में या शरीर के अंदर आपको दुखद लगता है या आपको पीड़ा होती है वो आपको असुखद वेदना है. वॉट एवर इज फेल्ट बॉडली और मेंटली एज नीदर स्मूथिंग और हर्टिंग इज नीदर पेनफुल नॉर प्रेजेंट. अगर कोई भी ऐसी वेदना है जो मन में या शरीर में ना ही वो आपको अच्छा लगे ना ही उसे पीड़ा हो तो उसे असुखद अदुखद वेदना कहते हैं. लेडी वॉट इज प्लेजेंट एंड वॉट इज पेनफुल इन रिगार्ड टू द प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. सो ऐसे क्या चीज़ जो सुखद है और क्या चीज़ दुखद है सुखद वेदना के अंदर. अभी आप बराबर समझिए क्या चीज़ सुखद है और क्या चीज़ दुखद है सुखद वेदना के पीछे और क्या चीज़ सुखद है और क्या चीज़ दुखद है दुखद वेदना के लिए. सो वॉट इज पेनफुल एंड वॉट इज प्लेजेंट इन रिगार्ड टू पेनफुल फीलिंग. What is pleasant and what is painful in regard to neither painful nor pleasant feeling. Friend Vaishakha, pleasant feeling is pleasant when it persists and painful when it changes. जो सुखद वेदना है वो सुख देता है जब तक वो रहता है और वो दुख देता है जब वो जाता है. Okay? Painful feeling is painful when it persists and pleasant when it changes. दुखद वेदना है जब तक वो रहती है वो दुख देती है जब जाती है वो सुख देती है. नीदर पेनफुल नॉर प्लेजेंट फीलिंग इज प्लेजेंट व्हेन देयर इज नॉलेज ऑफ इट. मींस असुखद अदुखद वेदना है जो आपको अच्छा लगता है जब तक उसका ज्ञान हो एंड पेनफुल और वो दुखद है जब उसका ज्ञान नहीं है. सो व्हेन डू यू हैव नॉलेज. जब कब ज्ञान होता है जब आप असुखद अदुखद वेदना में हैं कब ज्ञान होता है आपको और कब ज्ञान नहीं होता. व्हेन डू यू फाइंड दैट नीदर पेनफुल नॉट प्लेजेंट फीलिंग हैज नॉलेज इन इट एंड व्हेन डू यू फाइंड दैट नीदर पेनफुल नॉट प्लेजेंट फीलिंग हैज नो नॉलेज इन इट. ओके यू आर नियर टू दैट नियर टू द आंसर. Anybody else? No, that is there is no feeling over there. So neither painful nor pleasant feeling you are telling. Where does that knowledge is at? When you are in equanimity, जब आप उपेक्षा में रहते हैं तब आपका असुखद अदुखद के अंदर ज्ञान का रहता है. आपको ज्ञान है कि ये चीज है और असुखद अदुखद जब आप जैसे ऐसे ही बैठे हुए हैं समझो कभी सुबह है आप चाय पी रहे हैं और अच्छा तापमान है और आप ये चाय पी रहे हैं आपको इसका कोई भान ही नहीं रहता है कि क्या क्या हो रहा है यहाँ भी. क्योंकि जब आपका शरीर के अंदर दुख होता है तभी आप शरीर को आप ध्यान देते हैं. जैसे हाथ में दुख हुआ तो आपको पता चला हाथ है नहीं तो कभी आपको पता चलता है हाथ है क्योंकि तब जो है आपका शरीर जो है असुखद अदुखद की स्थिति में है तो आपको भान नहीं हो उसका. अगर समझो आपके शरीर के अंदर बहुत अच्छा तरंग आई खुशी की तो आपको शरीर के जो है वो पता चलेगा. यहाँ पे अगर कुछ चीज हुई तो आपको पता चलेगा मगर जब कुछ नहीं है तब वो शरीर का भान नहीं रहता है तब आपको उसका ये नहीं रहता है. सो व्हेन ए बॉडी हैज पेन वी काइंड ऑफ पे अटेंशन टू द बॉडी और नॉर्मली इट इज नॉन नीदर द पेनफुल नॉर पेनफुल. सो दैट स्टेट व्हेन इट इज देयर वी डोंट पे अटेंशन इट और वी पे अटेंशन इट व्हेन देयर इज अ प्लेजरेबल सेंसेशन हैपनिंग और इच हैपनिंग और समथिंग हैपनिंग दैट टाइम वी पे अटेंशन टू द बॉडी. सो नीदर पेनफुल नॉर प्लेजेंट फीलिंग्स हैज इग्नोरेंस इन इट. सो इट हैज व्हेन हैज नो नॉलेज. When you have no knowledge, that time it is painful. Because it is painful because that is ignorance. And there is a link for ignorance is the five things which I said. The arising, the passing away, the gratification, the danger and escape. These are the five things which I have spoke about yesterday. So these are the thing which is there in the state of neither painful nor pleasant feeling in the normal sense. That you are not sure when it comes, it goes. you are not sure of the gratification in it, you are not sure of the danger in it, and you are not sure of the escape from it. So that is the state of neither painful nor pleasant feeling. Lady, what underlying tendency underlines pleasant feeling? What underlying tendency underlines painful feeling? What underlying tendency underlines neither painful nor pleasant feeling? जो सुखद वेदना है, दुखद है या असुखद दुखद है, उसके अंदर क्या टेंडेंसी है, मीन्स उसका क्या आ, 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 उसके अंदर पीछे का जो है, क्या बोलते हैं टेंडेंसी को, क्या बोलेंगे हम, झुकाव है जो अच्छा झुकाव. फ्रेंड वैश्य का अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसी टू लस्ट अंडरलाइंस प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. तो जब आपका जो अच्छा सुखद भावना रहता है उसके अंदर आसक्ति रहती है, मीन्स उसका अंदर चिपकाव रहता है. द अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसी टू अवर्जन अंडरलाइंस पेनफुल फीलिंग. जब आप दुखद वेदना रहती है उसके अंदर आपका अवर्जन रहता है, मीन्स उसका घृणा रहती है. द अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसी टू इग्नोरेंस अंडरलाइंस नीदर पेनफुल नॉर प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. तो जो अविद्या रहता है वो ना ही सुखद ना दुखाव का झुकाव रहता है उसके पीछे का. Lady, does the underlying tendency to lust underline all pleasant feeling? Does the underlying tendency to aversion underline all painful feeling? Does the underlying tendency to ignorance underline all painful or neither painful nor pleasant feeling? तो इन्होंने बोलता है कि ये ऐसा झुकाव क्या सब सुखद दुखद और असुखद दुखद वेदना के लिए रहता है. फ्रेंड वैशा का द अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसी डज नॉट अंडरलाइन ऑल प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. द अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसी टू अवर्जन डज नॉट अंडरलाइन ऑल पेनफुल फीलिंग. द अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसी टू इग्नोरेंस डज नॉट अंडरलाइन ऑल पेनफुल और नीदर पेनफुल नॉट प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. मीन्स बोलते ना सबका वो वही झुकाव नहीं होता. लेडी, वॉट शुड बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. तो आपका अगर अच्छा सुखद वेदना है तो उसके अंदर क्या आपको त्याग करना है. वॉट शुड बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू पेनफुल फीलिंग. अगर आपका दुखद वेदना है तो उसके अंदर क्या किस चीज का त्याग करना है. वॉट शुड बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू नीदर पेनफुल नॉर प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. अगर आपका असुखद अदुखद वेदना है तो उसके अंदर क्या आपको त्याग करना है. फ्रेंड वैशा का अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसी टू लस्ट शुड बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. तो अगर सुखद वेदना है तो आपका जो आसक्ति है जो तनहा है उसको आपको त्याग करना है. द अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसी टू अवर्जन शुड बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू पेनफुल. जो दुख है उसके अंदर जो घृणा है उसका उसको आपको त्याग करना है. द अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसी टू इग्नोरेंस शुड बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू नीदर पेनफुल नॉर प्रेजेंट फीलिंग. जो आपका ना ही सुखद ना ही दुखद वेदना है उसके अंदर का जो अविद्या है उसको आपको त्याग करना है. लेडी, डज द अंडरलाइन टेंडेंसी टू लस्ट हैव टू बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू ऑल प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. क्या जो इसका झुकाव है आसक्ति का वो सारे जो सुखद वेदना है उसके अंदर आपको त्याग करना पड़ेगा. द अंडरलाइन टेंडेंसी टू अवर्जन हैव टू बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू ऑल पेनफुल फीलिंग. क्या जो इसका अगर दुखद वेदना है और उसके अंदर का जो घृणा का जो भाव है वो सारे ऐसे जो वेदना होती है उसको आपको त्याग करना है. डज द अंडरलाइन टेंडेंसी टू इग्नोरेंस हैव टू बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू ऑल नीदर पेनफुल नॉर प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. क्या आपका असुखद अदुखद वेदना है उसके अंदर जो अविद्या है उसको त्याग करना है हर बार. फ्रेंड क्वेश्चन का द अंडरलाइन टेंडेंसी टू द लस्ट डज नॉट हैव टू बी अबैंडन इन रिगार्ड टू ऑल प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. So the underlying tendency to aversion does not have to be abandoned in regard to all pleasant feeling. The underlying tendency to ignorance does not have to be abandoned in regard to all neither painful nor pleasant. So सब के लिए नहीं करना है इसे. Here friend वैशा का quite secluded from sensual pleasures, secluded from unwholesome state. A student enters upon and abides in the first jhana, which is accompanied by initial and sustained thought. With rapture and pleasure born of seclusion. With that, he abandons lust and the underlying tendency to lust does not underline that. So, जब आप पहले जाना में जाते हैं तब वहाँ पे सुख का अनुभव करते हैं, मगर उस सुख का अनुभव जो होता है वो आपका जो तन्हा को त्याग करके होता है. तो ये जो सुख का अनुभव है उसे त्याग करने की जरूरत नहीं है. तो जब आप मेडिटेशन में बैठे हैं और उसका सुख आता है, उस सुख को त्याग करने का जरूरत नहीं है, क्योंकि उस सुख के अंदर आपने पहले ही आपने जो आसक्ति का जो है उसमें आपने छोड़ दिया है. सो व्हेन यू आर इन ए जाना स्टेट द प्लेजर ऑफ दैट यू डोंट हैव टू अबैंडन बिकॉज दैट इज ऑलरेडी यू हैव अबैंडन द क्रेविंग व्हेन यू आर एंटरिंग दिस थिंग. सो देयर आर नो फाइव हिंड्रेंसेस इन दिस स्टेट दैट इज वी हैव लर्नड यस्टरडे. सो दैट इज द सेम थिंग हियर. ए स्टूडेंट कंसीडर्स दिस. When shall I enter upon and abide in that base that the noble ones now enter upon and abide in? So, यहाँ पे एक स्टूडेंट रहता है या एक शिष्य रहता है, वो सोचता है कि मैं कब ये सारे जो मेरे आसक्तियाँ हैं, लोभ द्वेष मोह है, उसको त्याग करूँ और मैं उस स्थिति में रहूँ जिस स्थिति में जो अरहंत रहते हैं, वैसे स्थिति में कैसे, या आर्य जो पुरुष रहते हैं उस स्थिति में मैं कैसे रहूं, वैसा वो सोचता है. इन वन हु हैव थस जनरेट्स ए लॉन्गिंग फॉर द सुप्रीम लिबरेशन. सो आई विल रिपीट दिस. इन वन हु जनरेट्स ए लॉन्गिंग फॉर द सुप्रीम लिबरेशन ग्रीफ अराइजेस विद दैट लॉन्गिंग एज कंडीशन विद दैट ही अबैंडन्स अवर्जन एंड द अंडरलाइन टेंडेंसी टू अवर्जन डज नॉट अंडरलाइन दैट. तो जब ऐसा उसका आसक्ति होता है तब उसको दुख होता है कि मैं आर्य पुरुष कब बनूंगा मैं, तब वो दुख जो है उसके अंदर घृणा का भाव नहीं है. तो वहाँ पे आपको जो दुख है उसको आपको त्याग करने का जरूरत नहीं है, क्योंकि दैट इज ए होलसम थिंग, मीन्स वो अच्छा सोच है. तो उसको उसका जो दर्द है उसको आपको मीन्स मिटाने का जरूरत नहीं है. Here with the abandoning of pleasure and pain, with the previous disappearance of joy and grief, a student enters upon and abides in the fourth jhana, which has neither painful pain or nor pleasure and purity of mindfulness due to equanimity. With that, he abandons ignorance and the underlying tendency of ignorance does not underline that. जब एक शिष्य जो है चौथे jhana में प्रवेश करता है तब क्या होता है, वहाँ पे जो है असुखद अदुखद वेदना है और वो असुखद अदुखद वेदना जो है वो क्या है, वो है उपेक्षा. तो जब वो उपेक्षा है वहाँ पे अविद्या नहीं है, वो अविद्या का त्याग होता है वहाँ पे, तो तभी उसको त्याग करने की जरूरत नहीं है. तो जब आप का जो सुखद वेदना होती है या दुखद वेदना होती है या असुखद दुखद वेदना है जो जाना के ऊपर है या वो जाना का पे पहुंचने के लिए है, अगर वो परिपूर्ण और अच्छी चीज़ है तो वहाँ पे उसको त्याग करने की जरूरत नहीं है. व्हाट इज होलसम यू डोंट हैव टू अबैंडन. सो द प्लेजर यू फेल इन जाना स्टेट्स यू डोंट हैव टू अबैंडन दैट नॉर यू हैव टू बी अफ्रेड ऑफ दैट नॉर द इक्वानिमिटी यू हैव टू बी अफ्रेड ऑफ. Those are already the lust and the ignorance has been eliminated at when you are at that stage. Lady, what is the counterpart of pleasant feeling? जो सुखद वेदना है उसका उल्टा क्या है? Friend वैशाखा, painful feeling is the counterpart of pleasant feeling. जो दुखद वेदना है वो सुखद वेदना का क्या बोलते हैं विरुद्ध है. व्हाट इज काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ पेनफुल फीलिंग. सुखद दुखद वेदना का विरुद्ध क्या है? सुखद वेदना जो है दुखद वेदना का विरुद्ध है. प्रेजेंट फीलिंग इज द काउंटर ऑफ द पेनफुल फीलिंग. व्हाट इज द काउंटर ऑफ द पेनफुल नॉन प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. सो उसका 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 साथ क्या है, काउंटर पार्ट? तो जो नहीं इग्नोरेंस इज द काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ नीदर पेनफुल नॉर प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. तो जो उसके साथ क्या है, तो जो असुखद अदुखद वेदना है उसके साथ में अविद्या है. जो सुखद वेदना है उसके साथ में दुखद वेदना है, सुख दुखद के साथ में सुखद है, मगर जो आपका असुखद अदुखद वेदना है उसका जो साथ है उसका साथ है अविद्या, इग्नोरेंस. इग्नोरेंस इज विथ नीदर पेनफुल नॉर प्लेजेंट फीलिंग. ट्रू नॉलेज इज द काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ इग्नोरेंस. मीन्स जो सही ज्ञान है वो अविद्या का साथ में है। सो मीन्स आपका आपको जब अविद अगर पूरी तरह से आपको ज्ञान होता है तो अविद्या मिटती है। तो उस तरह से ट्रू नॉलेज इज द काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ इग्नोरेंस। वॉट इज द काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ ट्रू नॉलेज? वेन यू हैव ट्रू नॉलेज वॉट इज द काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ ट्रू नॉलेज? डिलीवरेंस इज द काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ ट्रू नॉलेज। वॉट इज द काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ डिलीवरेंस? निब्बाना इज द काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ डिलीवरेंस। लेडी वॉट इज द काउंटर पार्ट ऑफ निब्बाना? फ्रेंड वेशाखा, यू हैव पुश्ड द लाइन ऑफ क्वेश्चनिंग टू फार, यू वेर नॉट एबल टू ग्रास्प द लिमिट ऑफ क्वेश्चन। सो देर इज अ लिमिट ऑफ क्वेश्चन, सो यू आर नॉट बियॉन्ड दैट क्वेश्चन। वेशाखा is grounded upon Nibbana, culminates in Nibbana, ends in Nibbana. If you wish, friend Veshaka, go to the Blessed One and ask him about the meaning of this. Has the Blessed One explained it to you? So you should remember it. So अभी आप अभी हम बताया कि अविद्या का जो पार्ट है वो सही ज्ञान है, सम्यक ज्ञान है। So सम्यक ज्ञान का क्या है? मुक्ति है। और मुक्ति का साथ कौन के साथ कौन है? मुक्ति के साथ में निब्बाना है। सो वेशाखा इससे आगे पूछता है निब्बाना के साथ क्या है। तो उसने बोलते हैं कि तुमने कुछ ज़्यादा ही पूछ लिया, ये निब्बाना में ही हमारा जो ये है होली लाइफ है वो खत्म होता है। अगर आपको कोई शक है तो आप बुद्ध के पास जाकर पूछ सकते हैं। तो हर एक सवाल का एक हद रहता है, उस हद से ज़्यादा सवाल नहीं पूछना चाहिए। सो देर इज ए पॉइंट, you should not ask a question beyond that. So then the lay follower Vishaka, having delighted and rejoiced in the Dhammadina, Bhikkhuni Dhammadina's words, rose from his seat and after paying homage to her, keeping her on his right, he went to the Blessed One. After paying homage to him, he sat down to one side and told the Blessed One in his entire conversation with the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina. When he finished speaking, the Blessed One told him, the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina is wise, Veshaka, the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina has great wisdom. If you remember, this is the same words used for Sariputta in 111, Majjhima Nikaya. Sariputta has wise wisdom, he has great wisdom. So this is the same words he is using for Veshaka also, because Veshaka is the most wise in the Bhikkhuni order. You have, if you had asked me the meaning of this, I would have explained it to you in the same way that the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina has explained it. Such is its meaning, and so you should remember it. That is what the Blessed One said. The lay follower Veshaka was satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. So, वो बुद्ध के पास जाके बोलते हैं, जो भी उनकी बात हुई वो बोलते हैं कि वैशाखा जो है बहुत ही पण्य है उनके पास में, और वो वही तारीफ करते हैं जो उन्होंने सरिपुत्ता के लिए कहे थे, क्योंकि वैशाखा जो है बिखुनी के अंदर सबसे पण्य के अंदर प्रमुख है। सो उस हिसाब से, और एंड वन थिंग आई जस्ट रिमेंबर्ड अबाउट ए क्वेश्चन समबडी आस्क्ड अबाउट द फीमेल जेंडर। सो यू कैन सी दैट देर आर सूक्तास इन दिस which are handled by the female gender, which is the Bhikkhuni suttas also there. Then there are suttas from bhikkhus also. And when Sariputta is praised as having wisdom, Dhammadina is also praised for having wisdom. जैसे किसी ने अभी पूछा था कि महिला पुरुष को किस तरह देखा जाता है बुद्ध के द्वारा, तो आप ये जान सकते हैं कि यहाँ पे भी ये मध्यमा निकाय के अंदर एक महिला जो है या भिक्खुनी है उनका सूत्र है, और जो तारीफ वो सरिपुत्ता की करते हैं वही तारीफ वो धम्मदीना की भी करते हैं। सो दे हैव इक्वली प्रेज्ड एंड इक्वली दे हैव गिवन द प्लेस इन द टेक्स्ट। सो देर इज वन अदर, आई थिंक इन अंगूत्र निकाय बाय धम्मदीना देर इज वन अदर सूत्र इच इज इन द अदर बास्केट ऑफ टेक्स्ट टेक्स्ट। अंगूत्र निकाय में भी धम्मदीने का दूसरा सूत्र है। So this is giving you a kind of a overview of your practice and of the advanced states you can expect and how it may progress for you. So ये आपको आपका जो आप कार्य कर रहे हैं यहाँ पे उसके बारे में बताया गया है, और आप आगे जाके क्या आप देख सकते हैं, क्या आप अनुभव कर सकते हैं, उसके बारे में ये आपको बताया गया है। तो इस तरह से ये बहुत ही आपको इम्पोर्टेंट इंफॉर्मेशन आपको दिया जाता है। सो इज देयर एनी क्वेश्चंस, कोई सवाल है? त्याग मीन्स अबैंडन, अबैंडन द अंडरलाइंग टेंडेंसीज।
यस, हाउ डू वी डू दैट?
व्हाट इज द राइट एफर्ट? दैट इज यू रिकॉग्नाइज इट, रिलीज इट, रिलैक्स इट, रीस्माइल इट एंड कम बैक टू व्हाट आर यू डूइंग। दैट इज द अबैंडनिंग ऑफ दैट।
सो सपोजिंग इफ देयर इज अ प्रेजेंट फीलिंग, सो वी हैव टू अबैंडन इट।
दैट इज व्हाट आई टोल्ड यू, दैट नॉट ऑल प्रेजेंट फीलिंग हैव लस्ट इन इट। When the pleasant feeling is associated with the jhanas in your meditation, those you don't have to abandon because they don't have the lust factor in it.
So whichever has the lust factor, that yes. has to be abandoned.
Abandoned, yes. So whatever in the life, you are going here, there, and as I told you about the cheesecake, somebody had an idea of a cheesecake and then he went 5 miles somewhere else and then found the shop to be closed. Even if the shop was open, he would have eaten the cheesecake. So what is the gratification of the cheesecake is there, but what is the danger of cheesecake is all cheesecake end one day. At one moment of time, that is the reason at that point of time the people are doing this, you know, scraping it. That is the danger of it, because that cheesecake is gone and then they take their finger and lick it. So that is the time when the danger has come in. And what is the escape? That is the sixth hour. If you had a thought of cheesecake and you said that that is just something, whatever I have with me, that I will be satisfied with, you recognize that, release that thought, relax, re-smile and just had whatever normal cake you had, fruit cake or something you had in the fridge, then you did not have that whole thing happen. So 6 hour is the right effort, and that has to be there in the life also.
So Guruji, whatever unpleasant, you have to abandon. Pleasant also abandon.
Abandon, yes. Unpleasant also you have to abandon by understanding that this is something which is impersonal. It is something which is impermanent, because it has come, it was not there, it has come and it will go away. And what is the dukkha in it? When you resist that pain, you are creating a dukkha. Why it has come? Why it is me who is getting this pain? Why am I the only one? What did I do in the future, in the past? What did I do to deserve this pain? All this is dukkha. If the let the pain be there, understand that it is an impermanence, understand it is impersonal, there is causes and conditions which brings this pain, and it is there and it will go away when the causes and conditions change.
But Guruji, such thought, that is the hard truth, but that thought is very depressive, don't you think so?
That is the development, that is depressive, when something hurt is there and you can depress you. But depressive is a mental state, is our own creation. It is our understanding of something. And how it is, what is that, is a wrong view we are taking. What are we learning is the right view. Right view is seeing that in the three characteristics, that what a reality is, everything which you can see and experience and measure is coming into these three categories. There is nothing which science can also say that there is anything which is permanent. They cannot say that, because they say that the space itself will kind of at one time did not exist. Before Big Bang, they say that space itself did not exist. So those are all the things which you have to understand, that there is, this are the fundamental things of existence. That is right view. Wrong view is you are taking it personally. That is the reason you are getting into fighting. And by fighting and failing, what you do is you give more energy to that negative emotion. When the no more energy there, you put more energy and you fight, and then you get exhausted, and there mental exhaustion is there, physical exhaustion is there. That is called depression.
So, Guruji,
You are keeping fighting, 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 fighting with something which you cannot fight with. You cannot win with. By fighting, you are giving the other party more and more this thing, power. Then how can, say if some two people come in, say a boxing ring. The more you hit him, the more bigger he becomes. There is one story which has been told by the Buddha. There was a yakka, there is a being. He came into a king's palace and saw there is a throne over there. So he went and sat on the throne. And the king was not there, and his staff came and said, "Oh, get out of there. This is king's this thing and everything." They were abusing him and everything. And he was getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And he just laughed at them and just stayed over there. Then they started throwing arrows and hitting, and then those arrows and everything he absorbed and becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. Now the king was the follower of the Buddha. So he said, "What happened? This being came and we did all these things and everything." So he said, "Okay, get some thing to for food to for him to eat." The king goes with the plate of food and says, "You are welcome. I am very happy that you have come." And then he gives him food. Then he becomes a little smaller. Then he gives him flowers as welcome. He gives gifts as welcome. He praises him, "What you are looking very beautiful," and all these things. And then he becomes smaller and smaller and smaller, and then he disappears. So the simile is there for that. When you have a negative feeling, when you are giving attention to it, you are fighting it, and you are abusing it. Why did I get this feeling? Why did I get this thought? Why did I do this kind of thing in the past? All these things are kind of accumulating, and you are giving energy. I don't want this. I don't want it. The don't want is also giving you attention to that. And when you get attention, it is getting powerful, 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 and at one time you get exhausted. And that is what a depression is. So when you understand how the function of energy works, how the function of attention works. So that is how we started the first day of this retreat. How do you put your attention? You put your attention on the wholesome, metta. So if you had a feeling of sad feeling, you put a feeling of metta and then send it to say the universe. May everybody be happy and may everybody be calm. Then what would your attention be on? The feeling of metta, what that creates, what you give, you get. What you get back is the feeling of metta you get back. So, what would happen to that feeling of hurt or depression or anything? That feeling would have come with a certain amount of energy. It would stay for that certain amount of time. And what would it do? It's after its energy is dissipated, it will go. It would not turn into a worst situation. When does it turn? When you try and fight it. When you try and fight something which is there. That is the definition the first day I gave you, is there is a truth. And then you fight it. And that fighting of the thing is dukkha. When you accept the truth, then you cannot create dukkha. So that is the simile of the arrow also. When the first arrow is hit, that pain, physical pain is there. But when you kind of sorrow, lamentation, grief, is that then you are hitting yourself with the second arrow. So that is the dukkha you are creating.
What I mean to say is, on one hand, we believe life is a very beautiful thing. So on the other hand, we understand it is not permanent. We are going to die. And
The beliefs are the things which you have accumulated. That is not what the Buddha is saying. Buddha is saying just look at the reality as it is.
This is so discouraging to go ahead with the beautiful life. No, that is right.
So that is what in this five things which I said was the gratification. So if the life did not have something beautiful or something enjoyable or something which you can like, then there would not be dislike, there would not be something painful. With pain, there is pleasure. So if there was only pain, then there is no possibility of pleasure. If there is only pleasure, then there should not be any pain. So there is, both are a part of the life. Okay, life is beautiful and life is also ugly. So that is reality. So you have to accept the life as it is. At as of now, how it occurs to you, you have to accept that. Without acceptance, there is resistance. When you resist, what happens? Dukkha. So whatever is your concepts of life is the concept you have made. So you have to understand what the Buddha is saying. Buddha is saying that these are just the concepts, and these concepts of life can be changed. Okay? Any other question? Yes.
Aren't we breaking a precept by using mosquito repellents?
Repellents is not a problem, because repellent is repelling them. Okay? Yeah, that is breaking a precept, because the first is not to harm living beings or kill living beings. Yes. What is happening? So I think they are repellents. Repellent is not a problem, because it repels. Huh? So I don't know about that, but if they are killing it, then that is...
Because if something is bothering you, then...
But you are not putting it, so you don't have to worry about that.
It's the same
logic.
You don't kill the cow, but the butcher kills the cow.
But that is what the logic Buddha has very clearly said about that. See, that you are not responsible for the butchering of the cow if you are eating the meat. You are not responsible for
the action. The action is also important. Why are you doing it?
See, that is what you are saying, that without you having, there are many millions and billions of people, who are vegetarians. Are there any reduction in the killing of cows, chickens or anything? No, if you see the graph, it is still growing. Because that is not dependent on you as an individual, if you do that or not. What is it dependent on is the person who has decided. And that you cannot say that the utopian feeling or utopian concepts are not there with Buddha. Buddha is saying this is the world the way it is. It was always like this and it will always be like this. What as an individual one can do is develop understanding of this world and get an escape from this world. You cannot control the world. If you are trying to control the world, make the whole world vegetarian or something like that, you are again fighting with the truth. So when you are fighting with the truth, then you again create dukkha for yourself. So one of the things about food is that when the non-vegetarian food, as Buddha has said, is that you should not be responsible for directly getting it killed. That is, you cannot go to a restaurant and say, I want this fish or I want this lobster. That is, you cannot do. You should not have seen or heard that. That is, you should not have, you cannot buy this from a place where they kill the animal. Or hear it killed. You should not have it if you suspect that this animal was killed for you. Like one of your friends or goes to a market, and you know that he goes to a pond and kills a fish and brings it for you. So that is something you should not do. Then there are animals which are considered to be harmful in the forest or something like that, like jackal meat,
elephant.
Elephant is because of royal, because it's a royal animal. Horse meat, because it is a royal animal in that time of the Buddha. Then I think there are other animals which have been snake. Meat of snake should not be done.
Especially when the human should not
be. That is needless to say.
In that context, I have read one lecture.
responsible for this, his own karma. So one example, solid example, is one of the suttas, Buddha has a debate with that one person. Now he loses the debate, and out of respect or out of guilt, he says that I'll feed the Bhikkhu Sangha. There are 500 monks and the Buddha. I'll call you for lunch for tomorrow's lunch. What he does is he has a large following. He says that I am calling the Buddha for lunch tomorrow. Please, whatever you have, you donate to me. So what they do is his followers come and donate it to him, the food. What he does is he takes the donation of food, he makes the food and then gives it to the Sangha. At the end, he says that, he asks the Buddha that what merit do I gain from giving this food to you? And what merit do my followers get from giving you this food? So the Buddha says that you have given the food to the Sangha. So you get the merit of giving the food to the Sangha. And your followers have given food to you. So they will get a merit which is equal to give to a food to a lay person. So even though that same food was given to the Buddha, the merit which was there is only for the person who has given. That was that debater who was there, who gave the food. He received the food and the people had given that food to him. So they get the merit for giving to an ordinary person. He was not an Arya or a noble person. He was not had any attainment. So he, as an ordinary person, whatever was there, that he got. So that is how we can understand that the merits are from your action. It's an individual thing. So if you feel that you don't want to eat meat or something like that, it's up to you. There is nothing harm in that. That does not mean that but it means that somebody who goes to a market and buys a packed piece of meat, that does not harm him also. So he is also not doing something bad. What is that is a neutral thing. What we are is that we should not do harm. That is what the five precepts are there. They are active harm. You are not in active harm. You are not in killing. You are not in robbing. You are not in the wrong sexual activity. You are not in wrong speech. You are not in wrong consumption of substances. So that are the things we are avoiding. Then what are the things which are doing good? Good is the dana you go. The metta is also a dana practice. When you smile at somebody, so my teacher says that you have to start with a smile and give that smile away, smile at somebody. So smiling is the one, you give metta, that is the positive thing, that is a positive thing. And what is the thing which is transcendent? Transcendent is the thing which we are doing over here, understanding how this is working. So in this space, food is a irrelevant thing. One sutta is there in which is attributed to Buddha Kassapa, but I think later on the monks changed it to Buddha Kassapa, but I think Buddha Gautama himself had said that. He gives about I think 30 things which come out of the, what you do or come out of the mouth which are harmful than what comes into the mouth. So at first, the food which you eat, if you are eating a meat, it's a neutral thing. It's not a positive thing, it's not a negative thing. If you are eating a veg thing, it's not a positive thing, it's not a negative. It's just a preference, it does not matter. If a person is eating veg, he's not gaining merit. And if a person is eating non-veg, he's not losing merit. It's just a neutral thing. But in the overall teaching of the Buddha, the teaching of the Buddha in short is, do not do harm, do good, and develop your mind. In these three things, that aspect is not kind of important. So it is an irrelevant topic in that sense. So you do good by dana and helping others. That is the thing you do good by. You avoid bad by keeping the precepts. You develop your mind by right effort. That is 6 hour you do, every time you do 6 hour, you are doing the right effort. So then you recognize what is unwholesome, you release the unwholesome, you relax, you let go of the tension and tightness or the craving which came with the unwholesome, you smile, you bring up the wholesome, and you do whatever task is there with the smile, with the wholesome mind. So that is how you develop your mind. So this is the whole teaching in short for the Buddha. So that is the reason we kind of avoid this topic, because it's a kind of a triggering topic for emotionally triggered.
So we can, you know, if we are sending metta to our living, and we are sitting in a room, we can send metta and still use the mosquito repellent, that would be okay.
So it is the, what I have told you about is the, if it, mosquito repellent, I am not sure, its name is repellent. Yeah, you can put Odomos or something like that. That is something, but that does not kill anything if you put an Odomos. That is, I think, sometimes it is seen that one monk was there in a, when I was in Thailand. He was there, I think, 20 years in the robes, and more than 20 years. And once, it was not my first hand, but a second hand, there was one other, I think, lay person who was staying in that monastery. He was staying in the forest monastery. So he went out with him, and there were a lot of gadflies, you know, those flies come and those were like a lot of flies. And he was kind of getting very much annoyed by this fly. And this monk, when he was going, the flies were there, but they were there in a circle around his head. But they were not touching him. They were like as a kind of a circle around his head, but they were not touching him. So that could be that he is sending metta. But I cannot kind of say that. We are not doing metta to solve a problem which Odomos can solve. You don't kill it, you can take a stick and throw it away, or you can hit, in the Vinaya also it is said you can punch. If somebody is coming to attack you and you are in danger, you can punch and run away. So that is the reason I think the Shaolin temple and all these things started initially, because they could, as per the rule, they could punch and get away, run away. So that's the reason. Maybe that started, but then they became its own thing, and it kind of developed new weapons and everything, and they kind of got into a bad space. So some things we can do. That is not something. One thing like if there is a physical attack happening on somebody, then you can come and come in between them. That is what the Buddha says. You can come in between them. That is what, but not attack that person directly. And come in between that person. So that is a simile of the saw that we'll take. We'll take a little bit part of that in the last day. So there are commonsensical rules which are there in Vinaya. If you read the Vinaya, there is a lot of rules which are there, which are weird rules, because those rules were put at the time of the Buddha. That was required, but in this time it would kind of feel weird. One rule is, I think no monk has broken that rule. No monk has broken this rule, Vinaya rule. That rule is that if you are there in a rooftop which has slits in it, which has gaps in it, and you are sleeping on a bed which has detachable legs in it, that is an offense. You understood? Say that if there is a roof, and say there are gaps in this roof, okay? There are slits put. There are gaps in this roof. And there is a bed put on the roof which has detachable legs. Not a solid bed, but with a detachable legs. Because what happened is, once a monk was sleeping like that, and the bed slipped, and the detachable leg fell down and hurt a lay person. So they came and complained to the Buddha, and the Buddha said, okay, I put a rule that they cannot sleep in such a roof. So some of them are there like that, and some of them are very commonsensical, because there are 10 reasons for putting the rules, Vinaya rules. That are one of those reasons is that to keep the cohesion in the sangha. That means that what is there, the law of the land or the belief of the land, that should not be harmed. Like the eating of meat, the fourth rule is of the animals. Many of the animals mentioned over there are royal animals. So if you eat a horse or something like that, then the royalty may kind of be offended. Or eat an elephant or something like that. So that were there. So there are many reasons for that. So for the betterment of the sangha, for the long term stay of the sangha. So there are 10 rules, there is a list of rules. I don't have it by heart. But there are many different aspects the Buddha has to see before you put any rules. So he used to think in a very dynamic manner before he used to kind of give the rules.
Guruji, when we walk, we kill any insects,
Without intention. So there is a first Dhammapada we read. What is that? Mind is chief, mind made are there. With a wholesome mind, whatever a person does, happiness follows that. Why with an unwholesome mind also that pain follows one. So there is a monk who is blind at birth, who is walking, doing a walking meditation. Okay, and when he goes to sleep, the other monks come and see that there are certain ants which have died on his walking meditation path. So they go to the Buddha, but the Buddha says that he is born blind, and there is a reason for it also. That story is that he was a physician, and somebody came for treatment of his eye. So they were blind, so he treated the eye, and the person became he started seeing, but did not pay the fees. Then he said, "Oh, one more treatment is there," and gave him medicine, poison. And the person again become blind. So because of that karma, he had suffered lot of times, and this time also he was born as blind. So he was born blind, and so he had no intention of killing the this thing. So there are you are in a realm of human realm. So there are many ways you can get killed. One way is the roof will cave. That way you can get killed. One way is you are walking and the car comes and hits you. You are in a car and the car hits a tree. There is an aeroplane. You go in. Aeroplane crashes. So there are many ways in that a human being can get killed. For an ant, one of the ways it can get killed is getting crushed by the leg. But for a intentional kill, there are some certain steps have to be there. So first is there is a living being, human or a living being is there. Then there is an intention to kill it. With that intention, there is an action taken. That action results in the death of that being. That is called an intentional killing. So when you are walking and ant dies, is that fulfilled? If any of those four things are not fulfilled, then it is not called an intentional killing. So there has to be a being. There has to be intention to kill the being with a specific action. Okay? That specific action has to be taken into effect. With that specific action, that being dies. That is the intentional killing of a being.
So, intentional killing is not a sin. No?
So, that is something which will happen. No, you are breathing and breathing in and breathing out, and you are killing a lot of bacteria. That is unintentional. You are not seeing it and deciding it to be killed. In your guts, the bacteria are outnumbering your cells, number of cells which you have. So in your guts, there are millions and billions of bacteria dying. So there is a lot of unintentional things. So that is the reason the Buddha says that only way to escape is by developing the right view. If you develop the right view, one of the things about this Eightfold Path is when you develop the right view, you develop the right intention. When you develop the right intention, you have the right thoughts. If you have right thoughts, you have right speech. If you have right things, you have right action. If you have right action, you have right livelihood. If you have right livelihood, you have right effort. If you have right effort, you have right concentration, mindfulness. If you have right mindfulness, you have right concentration. So one leads to another. So that is also, so right view is the chief. So if you have the right view, then other things all come into effect.
In that context, is it like we are also going through this karmic cycle? Is it something like that?
In that we don't have to worry about or think
why we act, because maybe karma was made to die.
No, not everything happens with karma. That is also we have to be assured of. One of the things Buddha said about getting ill, you know. So he gave 10 reasons for getting ill. Those were the medical reasons which were there. Upgoing wind, downgoing wind, sidegoing wind, or something like that. And one of the reason out of that 10 reason is karmic. When you get sick, so you can say that 10% chances that you are not sick because of the karmic reason. And one other thing about karmic is that some of the suttas he has mentioned what happens to a person, okay? Say like if you kill living beings, the next life if you are born as a human, you have a short life. If you don't kill living beings, you have a long life, okay? In the next human birth. So say if you have a long life in the human birth, but you die of an accident, then you are reborn in a heaven realm because you were not able to complete. So there is a happenstance always there. So there is nothing determined thing which is there. So there can be accident. So that ant may have died of accident also. So there is nothing definite we can say about that. Okay. Should I take this? What is written? What is the difference between
Dvesha
and Klesha. So I am not an expert in Pali, so I don't know. I think he can say Dvesh, kya bolenge? Klesha.
Dvesha means ye
dosha. Dosha is the hatred or this thing. Klesha is I think hindrances.
Suffering.
Huh?
Klesha. Suffering.
It is a little different. What does the klesh mean?
Conflict.
Huh?
Conflict
is in Hindi. This is in Pali.
No, Pali may have a meaning.
The Pali may have sometimes a different meaning. Dvesh, I think, is dosh. If it is there, then that means that it is aversion to something. And I don't know about klesh. This is a little. Klesh is underlying tendencies. Underlying tendencies are tendencies which are related to your past karmic
activation.
They are both used as negative, they are not used as positive. Yeah. Is awakening possible without a guru? In the sense that guru means that without the Buddha, it is not possible. Without a guru means without a guide or something like that, and then it is possible. If you are taking the Buddha as your guide, you directly take up, say, Panchima Nikaya or Anguttara Nikaya and start reading, and then you get insight into this, and then you practice, and then you attain awakening, that is possible. But you cannot say that it is possible without a Buddha.
How was it possible for Buddha?
How many possible?
How was awakening possible for Buddha?
Buddha took a lot of time. They gave us a kind of, I think, two Mahakapas or something like that. Two Asankhyas and one Mahakapa. Four lakh Asankhyas. I don't think so. That is that
yeah,
good.
Yeah.
Asankhya, there are four asankhyas in unmeasurable times in one Mahakapa, that is one cycle of existence. So he must have done it for a long time. So see, if I say one Mahakapa, that means that there are four periods of that. One period is when the world is just a tiny bit of compressed, okay, and it is just that one period. One period is it is expanding, which is now. It is expanding after the Big Bang. So before Big Bang, after Big Bang, after that it expands into such a space that it stops expanding. It is not possible. Even two atoms which are there, which will be separated. That is the expansion as per the physics or whatever they say. Then that state of being will be there for one asankhya. Then it all will come and back to the starting point. And then it stays over there. There are four stages. That four each stages are, I think they are calculated as about 100 billion years or something like that. We are at least, I think, 37 billion years or 17 billion years after the Big Bang. And so it will go on for, I think, whatever 37 billion years or something like that. So whatever is that in billions and billions. So that in visualization, if you have a 1 mile of granite, 1 mile over here of granite, 1 mile of depth, and 1 mile of height of a granite stone. Somebody comes with a soft cloth, skin silk cloth, and does one wipe every 100 years. With that effort, that whole granite is wiped away. That is the amount of time of one asankhya. So if you can imagine, so very huge amount of time. And that amount of time the Buddha practiced, and by this practice he did everything practically and did experiments and whatever was necessary. He in his last life he even cut his tongue and shoved it under his throat to stop the breathing. But after he finds that this nothing works, then he stumbled upon a memory of his childhood, where he finds the right this thing. Maybe he has learned somewhere in his life or something like that, but he has to do this. And then there are certain experiences one faces, like Devadatta. Devadatta was with Buddha for a long time in his life. He was the antagonist. There is a protagonist, there is a hero, there is a villain. So Devadatta was the villain of this story. So he was in the last thing what he did was, which was the worst thing, was trying to kill the Buddha. In that he injured the Buddha. When he injured the Buddha, he was assigned to a hell where he would have to spend a long time, like this billions of years. The hell is of a, it's like a molten tube of molten metal. And he is dropped into that metal and he feels that pain for a hundreds of thousands of years. He goes into the bottom. Then from that bottom he comes out and then he has his body reconstituted. He gets his body. And the time it takes to take a one breath, that time he gets a relief and then he again goes back into the pain runs. That he will go for billions and millions of years or billions of years and then he will be reborn. At the time when he will be reborn, there will be no Buddha era. There will be no Buddha at that point of time. So because of his experience of this pain, and there is a certain merit of being an antagonist or the villain in the Buddha story. Because for one to happen, the other has to be there, no? So there should be somebody. So by that is also having some merit. So for that merit and for the experience he has in that hell realm, because of that he will start doing meditation and he will start doing exploration, and then he will attain a Paccheka Buddha. He will become a Paccheka Buddha. So that is.
Guruji, sutras are not written by Buddha himself. No? Is it written by Sariputta?
There is not been written by anybody, but at that time of the Buddha, they had a system of memorization. So at the time of Buddha only, they had a memorization system, and there were certain, what was the Sutta Nipata was one of the things which was formally a collection of suttas by the Buddha, which used to be memorized. And one of the monks who comes, he says, this is a young monk, he has already memorized the Sutta Nipata.
Tripitaka
Tripitaka baad mein hai. that came afterwards.
So they will correct him now.
That is later. What happened previously at the time of Buddha, that is what I am talking about. So that was a formal practice which was there of memorizing the sayings of the Buddha as he said it. Then Buddha was asked by two of the monks who were also previously Brahmins, and they had a system of canonization of the teaching. So Buddha said, no, there should not be any canonization of my teaching. This should be, as I said, that has to be remembered. So then the memory of memorizing of the this thing was a formal practice at that time. At the passing away of Buddha, there was a first council of bhikkhus which was assembled. Then Ananda, whenever you say, thus I have heard, is the Venerable Ananda, from memory he is telling. He is called eidetic memory, I think so that is called. That is also called as photographic memory, but there is no photographic memory, but it is, they remember everything which is told. One of the things I found it interesting in a National Geographic magazine or something like that, was a lady who was reading an article about memory and said the rhetorical question was asked by the professor in that article. He said, do you remember what you had last Thursday? Do you remember what you had 6 months back in the morning in the breakfast? You don't remember. So he was talking about short-term memory, long-term memory and all these things. And then the lady said, but I do remember what I had last Thursday, and I do remember what I had in the last year in the breakfast. I clearly remember what is that. What is this nonsense he is talking about? So he was a Harvard professor or something like that. So he went and contacted the professor, and what you are saying this, but I remember this, what do you mean? So he said, okay, come and I will test. So they then tested her, and they found that to be, and they tested over the, as they are Harvard, they make it sure that whatever they have, they do very well. So this is not doing? So they do well. So they tested it her over the years, and they found it correct. She is talking correctly. And then they had research done on many people, and they found that out of 1 million people, one person has eidetic memory. That memory that he never forgets anything. There was a famous journalist in Russia who never forget anything. But he committed suicide because he had a breakup and he could not. Too much memory is also bad. But so he is very famous for not learning shorthand. Being a journalist and not learning shorthand, he used to go without a pen and pad, come back and repeat from his memory and write the stories. So that is possible, and that is normal. So say that council was there. Then they had all the suttas come into this. Then they divided this sutta into two major baskets. One was suttas and one was vinaya. Vinaya was all the sayings of the Buddha related to the monk discipline. Suttas were all the related to the dhamma. So the dhamma vinaya is also one word he uses in the Parinibbana Sutta, where he uses the word dhamma vinaya. He never uses the word abhidhamma as a collection of anything. So dhamma vinaya is there, and that is segregated into different books. That is, Majjhima Nikaya is middle length saying, Digha Nikaya is long length saying, then Anguttara Nikaya is numbered saying, Samyutta Nikaya is collection of theme collection. So all this way they collected those teachings. And those teachings were initially memorized, and for 500 years they had memorized those teachings. After 500 years, somebody thought that it needs to be put permanently. So I think in Burma they did it in stones, and in Sri Lanka they did it on palm leaves. So they still have some of those, they still have that. And there are monasteries dedicated to just preserving that this thing. In Burma, what he was mentioning, that the monks who memorize the whole Tipitaka are called Vibhamsa. So that is a kind of title a person gets for memorizing, and that you may have gone to exam which is 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, 6 hours, but this exam is for 1 month, and they are asked from this sutta, start from this third paragraph or something like that, and they have to start, and they get only 3 wrong answers in the 1 month testing. If they get a fourth wrong answer, they're out. They have to go back and memorize once again. So that is still there. Written is also there. And then there is a translation. There is in China they have gone. And China also they have the Tipitaka in China. I think Sutta Vinaya is there in Chinese also. And Bhikkhu Bodhi, who translates, and we use the Bhikkhu Bodhi translation of Majjhima Nikaya, the one I read now, he is now reconciling those things, and he finds that there is a lot of similarity between both the Chinese and this. They have a lot of similarities, and one is kind of confirming the other. So many of the, if you read his translations, he will kind of point out, and there are number over there. That's a clarification or an elaboration. So that if you go to that number, sometimes he kind of mention, this is mentioned in Chinese, this thing in this way, and this is mentioned in commentaries in this way. So he has a, he's doing that. So there is a kind of a lot of proof that this is in a very good shape. You cannot say 100%, but it's in a very good shape. It's enough good shape that we can use this to awaken ourselves. Correct.
I have one question.
Yes.
So, did Buddha say anything about suicide?
Yes. That is what he said, no? I read, no? The basic to be something is the basic fundamental kind of state of mind, to be something, and to not to be is also a fundamental state of mind. That is to try and eliminate yourself. But that is not possible, because when you can eliminate is this body, and the mind remains. One example a monk gave was, say what if you shoot yourself and you just have this pain, and you see this body is over there and you still are in pain, and what is your last state of mind is remains for a long time. So that pain will take you to a hell realms, and you will be there for a long time, and that could be kind of a very painful experience. But that has not, you have not succeeded in eliminating, you have just succeeded in eliminating the body. So you have to kind of consider that, and if you have wrong views, one of the wrong views is that you can you can eliminate yourself. That is, there should be no being. That is the fundamental thing. That is also told in the first sutta or the first sermon he gave, that the fundamental states of mind, to be and to not be.
To be or not to be. That is the question.
That is not the question, because we don't have a say in being, because we are already there, and we have no say in not being also. So that is never the question. So now what you have to do is understand this thing. When you understand this, which is happening is a process of cause and effect, cause and effect. So what we are doing is, we are doing 6 hours and eliminating that thing. And we are going and seeing what is there. So we are not getting attached to things which are unwholesome, and we are attaching ourselves to wholesome. That is how we kind of become awakened, by knowing the truth. By knowing the truth, one gets awakened. Can someone have an awakening without others' guidance? No. That is what in that sutta we mentioned, that others' voice was mentioned clearly. Isn't eating non-veg breaking the will? That we just explained. Does the craving, I like it, also develop as a tension in us? Yes. I like it is also, I like it and I don't like it as the same thing, the same space of the coin. There are two faces of the coin. One is I like it, and the other face is I don't like it. I don't want is also I want don't. Okay, so this is the way. It is the same thing. If someone is in higher jhanas, can he or she fall back to the lower ones in the same birth? No. In the same birth means if somebody is practicing as a higher jhana, then if he does not practice, he starts doing wrong things and all these things, then he can slip back. Okay? He stops practicing, then he can slip back. But one of the things my teacher said was that was a kind of a thought in Burma, is that if you attain even the first jhana for some time, that merit is so high that you will be reborn in a heavenly realm if you die. So, but that is not clearly mentioned, but similar thing has been mentioned over here in this thing, but it is mentioned that you are practicing and you are well accomplished in the jhana. If you are well accomplished in that jhana, then you will be reborn in the corresponding jhana, heavenly realm. And you may also be able to progress there and attain awakening, because you have been learning this meditation as per the Buddha's instruction. But in this life, if you are unheedful, then you can fall back. But if you have attained Sotapanna path, the Buddha says, however unheedful you are, you will not see the eighth birth. See the eighth birth.
Eighth.
So you will see in seven births you will be awakened. You will not see the eighth birth. So that is what the Buddha says. But if you are unheedful before reaching Sotapanna, then you can slip back. You can slip back into the lower jhanas or without jhana also. So you have to be careful about the sila. Sila is a kind of the foundation, your conduct, five precepts. You have to be kind of very clear about the five precepts. Do all sects types of Buddhism lead to the same journey? If all have the same teaching, then what the Buddha teaches, that is what. The sex does not matter. What sect I am from does not matter. What I am teaching does not matter. What the Buddha's words I am saying. So this teaching is not my teaching. It's the Buddha's teaching. I am not saying anything which is original from my mind or thinking or logic or something like that. Whatever I am saying over here, which I have learned or I have learned from my teacher, which he believes that it is the only way of the Buddha's. That is the reason we read the Buddha, because the Buddha was skilled communication, in communication. So what he says is correct. Okay? So we'll share the merits.
We go more into the teaching, no?
We have gone a lot into the teaching. We have three more sessions after this. Today ends and we have three more sessions. One session we will dedicate to what you do, how to take this practice to life. And two more of the Dhamma practice and more we will take. Okay? We'll share the merits. May suffering ones be suffering free and the fear struck fearlessly. May the being shed all grief and may all beings find it. May all beings share this merit that we have thus acquired for the acquisition of all kinds of happiness. May beings inhabiting space and earth, devas and nagas of mighty power, share this merit among us. May they long protect the Buddha's dispensations. Somebody switch off that.